Welcome to our live teaching learning session. I am Riya Pramanik. So I teach you BPSC 131, that is Introduction to Political Theory. This will be the concluding session on this topic and this subject, and I will be discussing all the important topics today in our lecture. So I will be revising all the important topics we have done so far in this course, that is Introduction to Political Theory. So let's start. So the first lecture on this subject was on politics. What is politics and what is political theory? So here I already told you about all these things, but because it is a revisionary session, we will be discussing about it in brief. So this is one of the most important topic, which is very important to understand. So it is defining politics. So the term politics is derived from the Greek word polis, meaning both city and state. So the term politics is derived from the word polis, which is a Greek word, and the meaning of this word polis is city and state. So when we talk about politics, we can see that there are two kinds of views which emerged while defining this term. So one is a narrow view and one is the broader sense in which we understand politics. So let's see what does politics means in narrow view, which we heard in our day-to-day life. So politics is considered to be rivalries of politicians in their struggle for power. So the narrower view of politics is that we often understand politics because whatever we see in our newspaper, television, that how the politicians are fighting with each other, they want to grab the highest most power. So for that, the rivalry, we consider that rivalry as politics. But this is not politics at all. It is just the narrow view. So if we want to understand politics in a broader sense, we should know that politics is a collective activity. So for politics, it is very much needed that people and individual comes in a collective and they do some kind of activity. So politics need individuals coming in a group. So politics is about power and how it is distributed. So one of the major thing which is related to politics is that it talks about power. How, why and how power, what we understand by this, it is about gathering or getting power so that they can rule people. So politics is about power and how that power is distributed among different individuals and different institutions. This is all about politics. So politics involves reconciling differences through discussion and persuasion. One thing which is very much needed for a politics is discussion and persuasion. So whenever individual comes in a collective, they talk about a topic or a subject, it is believed that they will come to a conclusion after discussions, deliberations and persuasion. So according to Shively, politics is working out rationally the best common solution to a common problem. So what does Shively means? Tell us about politics? It is about getting the best solution, common and best solutions after deliberations and discussions to a common problem. So suppose there is a common problem arising in a city or a state. So all the people involved in politics, they will gather, they will discuss, they will persuade each other, and they will find out a best common solution to that problem. So this is politics. Now let's move on to know what Aristotle tells about us in about politics. So according to Aristotle, politics is an inescapable feature of the human condition. That means if you are born as a human being, then it is compulsory that you will be politically involved, because it is something which no human being can escape. So he said, which is a very famous quote of Aristotle, that is, man is by nature a political animal. That means whether you are interested or not, but some way or the other, you will be involved in politics. So, people can only express their true nature as reasoning, virtuous through participation in a political community. So, what Aristotle says about politics, that people can express their true nature as reasoning, virtuous through participation in a political community. So, it is very much needed that people participate in politics. So, one of the major thing which is very important in political theory and in political science, and that role plays by the state. So, state is one of the core topic which is very much related with politics. So, we should understand, and as we already read about topics from this subject, we should know that how and why state is so important. So, state plays a very integral part in political theory and political science. So, let's understand what is state. State is not same as the government, as we already discussed about it, that government is only one part of state. State is more than government, and it is not equal to, or you can't use these two words interchangeably, because state is not same as the government. The agreement of the individuals on the means whereby disputes are settled in the form of law. So, what is a state? It is an agreement between the individuals so that all the disputes, all the problems should be settled by the form of laws. So, in a state, it is very much needed that there is codified laws through which all the problems, all the matters will be solved. So, state is a complex of various elements of which the government is only one. So, as we already talked about this, that state is a very complex element and government is only one among all those things. And we will be discussing about it in our next slide. So, let's see what are the elements of state. What are the things which constitute a state, which makes a state? The first and foremost requirement or element of a state is the population. Without population, we can't say that it is a state because it can't make a state. So, population is very much important. The people, the individuals, they comprises a state. And here comes the concept of citizen and alien. So, let's talk about what whom we call as citizen and who are aliens. So, citizens are those people who resides in a particular state within a territory or within a boundary, whereas aliens are people who belongs to some other state but coming in a different state. So, for example, for Indians, we will be citizen of India because we lived here, we get birth here, and that's why we are citizens of India. But if we go outside in some other country, for example, if we go to Sri Lanka, we will be alien over there because we are not their original or their natural citizens. So that's why there is a difference between citizens and aliens. Foreigners or migrants, they are alien. And citizens are those who have their rights to stay in a state, whether it is by birth or through naturalization. So, there is a difference between citizen and alien. Next come, the next important element of state is territory. Territory is very important because not only territory, but fixed territory. Why? Because in earlier times, there were kingdoms and there were many scope when a kingdom wanted to increase their territory. So, through wars, they used to acquire land from other kingdoms. But in states, it is very much needed that there should be fixed borders so that it will be constituted as state and not a kingdom. So, there is a difference between state and kingdom because in kingdom, there is a scope of increasing or decreasing the territory. But in state, it is very much needed that the boundary, the demarcated territory should be fixed. The third element which comes under state is government, as we already talked about it, that government is only one part of it and not the whole. So in government, we used to mean legislature, executive and judiciary, which is three organs of the government, which is present in each and every country where there is parliamentary or presidential form of government. So by legislature, we mean that a place or a group of people who decides what policy should be undertaken, what decisions should be there, what rules should be there. So they used to deliberate, they used to discuss among themselves, and they form a law or a policy. Executive is the group of individuals who will be implementing all the policies, all the laws produced by legislature. So, for example, in India, the legislature is the parliament and the state legislatures who formulate rules and regulation, laws, policies. So, legislature makes the policy, and the executive is the prime minister and his cabinet ministers who will be implementing those policies in all over the country. So, next comes the third organ of the state or the government, I need to say, is judiciary, which is the custodian of the constitution, because it is the judiciary which will ensure that whatever policies and rules are formulating by the legislature should not go against the constitution of the country. All the laws and policies and rules should be according to the constitution, and whenever it is seen that the policy is not going with the constitution or going against it, so at that point of time, judiciary has the right to object it. So judiciary plays a very important role, because it is the one who believes and who ensures that the all the things are done in the country should be according to the constitution. So this is all about government, where we talked about three organs. Next, and the most important thing for a state is sovereignty. What does sovereignty mean? It means when a state is taking its decisions on their own without any external influence. So, for example, if we talk about India, during British rule, before 1947, India was not sovereign. Why? Because all the decisions are taken by some external factors or external countries who don't belong to the state. So that at that point of time, India was not a sovereign country. But since 1947, all the decisions, whether internal or external, it is us who used to take all the decisions without anyone's interference. So after 1947, India is a sovereign country. But earlier it was not, because it was under colonization of Britishers, and all the decisions regarding the country were taken by some outsiders. So this is sovereignty, and this sovereignty is one of the most exclusive element of the state. So state can't become a state if there is no sovereignty. So it is one of the most exclusive element of the state. So let's talk about various forms of state. So the modern nation state arose after the Treaty of Westphalia, which was signed in 1648. So before that, kingdoms were there, but the state, the modern nation state, arose after the signing of Treaty of Westphalia in the year 1648. So there are various forms of state, there are various perspectives. So the first perspective is liberal perspective. The early view of liberal perspective was that it was considered to be negative. Why? Because it favored non-interference in individual matters. So it was believed that state should not intervene or interfere in individual matters, otherwise the freedom, the rights will be hampered of the citizens, which is not good. So according to them, state should not intervene, should not interfere in the personal matters of its citizens. But this view changed over time, and in the 20th century, there was a concept emerged from this, is that welfare state, which tries to reconcile individual liberty with social good. So in welfare state, it was believed that state should intervene for the welfare of the citizens who belong to very marginalized section or from deprived groups. They will be providing some kind of welfareism so that they can enjoy the best resources. So this was believed that state should be a welfare state. So there was a change in views. The early view was a negative view, but in 20th century, the definition or the work of state changed. Next, talk about Marx's perspective. So Marx's perspective totally rejects the liberal idea, and they believe that state is an instrument of a class which is more dominant, more powerful, and economically well off. So they believe that state is something or instrument or a tool in the hands of the bourgeois class or the capitalist class. So they warned, the Marxist perspective talks about a total stateless, classless society where there will be no state, no class. And how this kind of state will emerge? It will be emerging through the proletarian revolution. So in a capitalist society, when there will be stark distinctions between a bourgeois class and a proletariat class, it is believed that proletariat, after experiencing so much exploitation over the years, they will revolt against them, and at the end of that revolt, we will be finding a classless and stateless society, because according to Marx's perspective, state is a tool in the hands of the rich people. So this is all about Marx's perspective. Let's move on to feminist perspective. So according to liberal feminist, state can play a role in bringing equality among men and women. So liberal feminists believe that state should play a role so that there should be equality in the society between men and women. Whereas the radical feminists say that state as an instrument of power and blame unequal distribution of labor. So according to radical feminists, they say that state is an instrument of power, and they blame state that there is inequality in the society because it is the state who distribute the labor, the resources unequally among men and women. So these were the various perspectives we talked about state. So in this first block, we also have read about legitimation of power. And here we talked about Max Weber on legitimation. So he talks about three types of domination and legitimation of power. So let's move forward and see what does all these three kinds mean. So according to Max Weber, he talks about traditional domination, where holders of power can appeal to tradition and habit, and authority has been vested personally or in their families. So because of traditions going on since ancient time, power is vested in a person because of his family structure or traditions which were there from very long time. So for example, if there is a king, he is becoming king even though if he is not capable of becoming a king, but he is given that power. Why? Because traditionally he used to have that power. So this is what about traditional domination. Let's talk about charismatic legitimation. So according to Max Weber, there are some kind of exceptional personal qualities which the leaders used to have, which allows them to exercise their powers more on other people. So for example, if we talk about Mahatma Gandhi, he has some kind of charismatic personality which allows him to make a movement, the national movement, as mass movement. So there is some kind of charismatic personality which through which he was successful in coming off of such a huge movement against the British colonial rule. The third category of legitimation of power is the legal rational legitimation. That means a power which is authorized by specific rules to command and strictly defined spheres of action. So for example, if we talk about a civilian and an army person, or civilian and a police officer, there is a distinction in their powers. Why? Because police have more powers than us, because through rules, because of his position, he has some kind of extra powers which we normal citizens don't have. So, like police, the army men, they have some kind of power, rules, because that were written and they were given these kinds of power because of their some kind of specific rules and regulations. So, let's talk about political theory. What is political theory? So, political theory is two words. It is a combination of two words, two Greek words rather. One is polis and one is theoria. So, political theory, the political comes from polis, which means city-states. So, in ancient Greek period, there were many city-states where there were kingdoms, where some city-states were having democracy. So, polis means city-states, whereas theoria means explanation of anything. So, this is political theory. So, let's understand what does political theory mean. So, theory means an emotional thinking about a subject which tries to give a solution to the problem. So, we can say that in a society, there are many problems. And theory is the thing which of that subject so that it could find a solution to that problem. So, theory includes description of facts, explanation, and historical awareness. Political theory also helps us to understand the concepts that shaped our politics. So, there are many concepts like equality, sovereignty, fraternity, freedom. So, political theory helps us to understand all those concepts that shaped our politics. So, anything from a plan to a piece of abstract knowledge can be described as a theory. So, if we wanted to know what is the exact meaning of theory, so it can be anything from a plan or a abstract knowledge, it can be described as a theory. It involves the analytical study of ideas and doctrines that have been central to political thought. So, this is all about political theory. There are two kinds of political theory, normative political theory and empirical political theory. So, the normative political theory is concerned with political values such as justice, liberty, equality, and ancient political philosophers like Plato and Aristotle talks about how to make a better government. So, this was the question that arises in normative political theory, that how to make a better government from the one which was existing at that point of time. If we talk about empirical political theory, it is concerned with the political institution and political behavior. So, in modern times, it deals with nature and structure of the government. So, there is a distinction between normative political theory and empirical political theory. So, let's move on to another topic which we have already read in our this course, that is liberty. And we will be briefly seeing what does liberty mean. So, liberty is one of the core concepts and a fundamental democratic value. It is most commonly understood as absence of restraint. So, whenever we say that there is no one to stop us, so we can say that we have freedom because it is understood as absence of restraints. So, the concept of liberty emerged in modern Europe with the establishment of new economic and political relations. So, the notion was the idea of a rational individual who is capable of taking reasoned decisions. So, it was believed that all human beings are rational individuals. So, they have rationality, they can reason, they can take their own decisions, and thus nobody should require someone else to take decisions on their behalf. So, people should be given freedom. Why? Because they are supposed to be a rational human being who can reason, who can take their own decisions. So, individual required freedom from all kinds of social, political, and economic constraints. So, it was believed that nowhere people should be restrained from doing something. So, a person considered free to do something when his or her actions or choices are not hindered by those of another. So, there is a condition because it is not like that anyone want to do anything can do. If suppose a person is saying that I want to kill a person, so in that case you can't do it, because and it is not like that with that we couldn't stop that person because it's her freedom or his freedom to do whatever he want to do. But in that case we should understand that you can enjoy your freedom only if you're not hindering someone else's freedom. So the person who wants to kill is hindering the freedom of life to the other person whom he or she is wanted to kill. So in that case we can see that you can enjoy or you can you are free only if your actions or your choices are not hindered by those of another. So this is a condition for liberty. So we have already talked about the different negative and positive liberty, two distinctions. So we will be understanding today in brief that what does negative and positive liberty means. So negative liberty means absence of something. So what absence? It is the absence of the obstacles. Whereas positive liberty means presence of something. Whose presence? It is the capacity. So to understand this, let's take an example. So for example, a bird in a cage. So a bird in a cage lacks negative liberty to fly. How? Negative liberty talks about absence. So if a person, so for example, if we take this example of bird, she is behind cage and the bars, what are the obstacles? The bars of that cage, which is not allowing her to fly. So in this case, we can say that negative liberty, the bird doesn't have any negative liberty. Why? Because that cage is an obstacle who is not allowing her to fly. If we take about the example of penguin, so we can say that penguin lacks positive liberty to fly. That means there is no obstacles to the penguin to fly, but she lacks positive liberty because there is no presence of the capacity to fly. So although nobody is restricting the penguin to fly, but she is unable to fly because she lacks the capacity. So this is the difference between negative and positive liberty. And we should understand that it is nothing that negative liberty is some kind of negative thing and positive is positive. No, it is about the absence and presence of something. So absence of obstacles in negative liberty and presence of capacity in positive liberty. So there are two concepts of liberty according to Isaiah Berlin. So this particular topic is very important from the exam point of view. Isaiah Berlin's two concepts of liberty. So he talks about negative and positive liberty. Let's see what Berlin's views are there on this. So Isaiah Berlin says that negative liberty, individuals should be left alone. So in negative liberty means there should be no kind of restrictions on individual and he or she should be left alone. So where he or she should be left alone? In public activities, private activities and life goals. So he says that why individual should be left alone? Because an individual knows his or her interest best. So for example, if a person is not allowing their kids to go outside, kids in the sense, for example, a parent is not allowing their children to go outside for a party. So negative liberty will say that the person, the children who are going out for a party will be knowing their interest best and they should be left alone. So in public activities, private activities, life goals, they are supposed to be left alone. And here, Isaiah Berlin says that no person can act like an obstacle. So, if there is curfew, so a person wants to enjoy his negative liberty, in that case, it will not work because the obstacle is not a person. So, Isaiah Berlin says that no person can act like an obstacle. And here we should understand that government, social norms, or traditions will come under this. So in Negative Liberty, he talks about role of state. So state can't decide for you and intervene. And provide state provides just the legal framework where we can pursue our goals. Okay, so state is something which should not intervene in people's matters. And it is sometimes said that negative liberty is about freedom to starve. But we should understand that it is not about freedom to starve. So why it is called freedom to starve? Because, for example, if a person is very poor and is dying of hunger, in that case, negative liberty will not want the state to intervene because it will be believed that the person's liberty will be hampered. But in that case, the state is required to help that person to move out from the hunger. So, state intervention is not completely prohibited in negative liberty, which we should know, because state intervention is not completely prohibited, but it is said that state can't take decisions on your behalf. So let's move forward to positive liberty. Here, the individual has some freedom to become and freedom to do. So what freedom to become? What one should become, and freedom to do what one should do. So there is a should attached to this. So this is about positive liberty, where a person is where a person should not go or should not become a thief. So in positive liberty, it talks about that whether you have freedom or not, but you can't become a thief. Because you should not become, because it's a wrong thing. So, and a person can't kill another one because he has freedom. But what one should do. So, killing a person is not a good thing. So, positive liberty restricts that. So, positive liberty talks about a theory of self. Isaiah Berlin talks about higher self and lower self. So the higher self is controlled by reason. So according to higher self, the freedom is self-mastery. How? A person should know what he or she should do. And if he or she take decisions after reasoning and with rationality, then the freedom is self-mastery. Whereas there is a lower self which is controlled by desire and irrational activity. So, in a person, there is both lower self and higher self. And Isaiah Berlin warns that a person should dominate their lower self and should achieve the higher self, which will be controlled by reason. So, let's move forward to different types of equality, which we have done in our course. So, let's talk about formal equality. So, all individuals should be treated equally. So, the first and foremost concern of formal equality is about treating every individual equal. So, the idea is the principle of legal equality or equality before law. So, in front of law, nobody will be discriminated because of his educational background, economic background, social background, or because of his class, caste, religion, gender. So it is very much needed that in front of law, everyone is same. Whether he is the judge of the court or the prime minister of the country, nobody will be discriminated because of his or her background. So individuals should be treated equally by the law, irrespective of their caste, race, color, gender, religion, social background, and so on. So this is all about formal equality. Next comes the equality of opportunity. So, here it is believed that there should not be any kind of obstacles that can prevent a person of self-development. So, there must be removal of all obstacles that prevent self-development of an individual. So, career should be open to talent and promotions should be based on abilities. So, in case of for example, there are two candidates for a job position. So it should be the selection should be on the basis of the talent and ability, and not because of the social or economic or educational or the other things which are not required or not necessary for the job. So like two persons are there for a job, one from higher caste and the other from lower caste. So there should not be any kind of discrimination on the basis of their caste, because the job should be given on the basis of talent and abilities. So the qualities like talent, skills, hard work, and so on are morally defensible. So there can be inequalities, but where? Only in talent, skill, and hard work. If a person is hardworking, whether he belongs to high or low caste, there should not be any kind of discrimination. So whereas socially created differences like poverty, homelessness are not. So equality of opportunity talks about inequalities which are acceptable, that is talent, skill, and hard work, whereas socially created inequalities or differences like poverty, homelessness are not acceptable. Next comes the equality of outcomes. So it is a Marxist point of view, Marxist opinion that any right to equality circumscribed by a bourgeois economy can only be partial. So they believe that equality, which is in a bourgeois economy or a capitalist class, is only partial. It is not fully given to each and every member of the country. So absolute social equality can be achieved only when private property be abolished. So it is believed that whenever the private property will be abolished, then only the social equality will be achieved. And to abolish the private property, Marxist thinkers or Marxist ideology want the state to wither away, and there must be classless and stateless society. So it measures how successful we actually are, whereas equality of opportunity is a measure of how equal chances of success are. So there is a difference between equality of opportunity and equality of outcomes. So the difference is the equality of outcome measures how successful we actually are, rather than equality of opportunity, which measures how equal chances we have of success. So there is a difference between this. So let's talk about justice, which is one of the most important concept in this course, Introduction to Political Theory. And it is very important to understand the term justice and what does it mean. So justice is one of the important aims of the state. So whenever a state was created, the first and foremost thing that was the essential thing of the state was to provide justice to each and every people of the society. So justice was the central concept of Plato's Republic. So Plato wrote a book which is a very famous and a classic book for political theory, Republic, the Republic. In that, justice was the central concept. So the justice concerns the right of the individual as well as the social ordering of society. So justice is required in a society for the maintenance of peace and order. So if there are injustices happening in the society, there will never be peace and order in that society. So we can see in many historical events where the king is very rude to people, and he is very corrupted, and he is not giving proper justice to people. In that kind of society, there were no peace and order. There were always anarchy. So to maintain the peace and order, justice is required in a society. So the idea of justice is integrally connected with the norms of law, liberty, equality, and rights. So they are integrally connected. So let's see what John Rawls's theory of justice is. And this is also one of the most important topic of this course. So Isaiah Berlin's two concept of liberty is important. John Rawls' theory of justice is important because they are one of the pioneers of all these ideologies. And because of their book, we got something new in our political theory. So John Rawls's book was named as A Theory of Justice, where he talks about Wheel of Ignorance. So what is Wheel of Ignorance? It is a hypothetical original position. That means it was not something in reality, but a hypothetical position, where original position where people were behind the wheel and were unable to know what will be there, what will be their position, their social background, economic background outside the wheel. So in that circumstances, people will agree to accept two principles of justice. When you are behind the wheel and you are in a hypothetical original position, at that point of time, people will agree on two principles of justice. What were there? So each person is to have equal right to the most extensive liberty compatible with a similar liberty to others. So the first thing which people will agree upon is to provide equal right to the most extensive liberty compatible with a similar liberty to others. They will provide as much liberty as can and provide as much equal right as they can, because they don't know that after the wheel of ignorance is not there, what will be their position in the society, whether they will be a woman or a man, or belonging to a rich background or a poor background. They don't know whether they will be healthy or they will be having some kind of defects in their body. They have no idea like that. In that case, they want to make a society which is very equal for all, so that if they belong to a poor family, then at that point of time also, he will not suffer for lack of liberty or lack of equality. So in that case, they will provide most very much equal rights to all, so that there should not be any kind of discrimination. The second thing which will they agree upon is the difference principle, which means that inequalities can only be justified if it benefits the least advantaged. So for example, if a person is not allowed to use a lift because the lift is only for the disabled person, at that time this inequalities will be justified because it is benefiting the least advantaged person standing over there. So this is the difference principle, and individuals have to make a choice of social order. They would naturally prefer an egalitarian society. Under the wheel of ignorance, they will prefer an egalitarian society. So let's move on to the meaning of rights. Rights are called social claims. It helps individuals attain their best selves. So to become a best person, best human being, you require some kinds of rights. So it helps them develop their personalities, and a democratic government can best serve the people if it maintains a system of rights of its people. So for a democracy to run properly, it is very much important that the people residing in a democratic government or a democratic state, they should be provided rights. So states never give rights, they only recognize them. So there is also a sentence which make us believe that it is not state which give us rights, it only recognize them. Because if a person is not staying in a state, at that point of time also, he or she must have some kind of rights. So government never grant rights, they only protect them. So rights are essential conditions of human personality, and different state systems recognize different rights. So the amount of rights, or there are many different kinds of rights which are provided by different states. So we can't say that whatever rights we have here, we will also the people living in Africa will get the same rights, because from here and there, there will be difference in rights. So rights incorporated in the constitution of the land are called fundamental rights. So all those rights which are granted through the constitution are known as fundamental rights. Right to life is a basic right without which all other rights are meaningless. The first and foremost and most important right is right to life. After having this right only, we can have or we can enjoy all other rights. So right to life is a basic right without which all other rights are meaningless. So let's move forward to understand democracy. So democracy is believed to be originated in Athens in the 5th century BC. So the origination or the evolution of democracy or democratic concept, we can find it in Athens. That was a Greek city-state in the 5th century BC. The word democracy is derived from the Greek word demokratia. So democracy, the word democracy arrived from a Greek word that is demokratia, where demos means people and kratos means power. So it is a combination of two Greek words, demos and kratos. Democracy stands for rule by the people and the government which is based on the consent of the ruler. So what is the difference between a monarchy and a democracy is that in monarchy, all the decisions are taken by the king and the people residing in that kingdom are not citizens but subjects. They should obey the king whatever he or she is doing, king or queen. But in a democracy, it is the rule by the people and the government is only based on the consent of the ruled. That means it is on the consent of the citizen that the government is in a power. So there is a difference between direct and representative democracy. So let's talk about direct democracy. So the direct democracy is based on direct and unmediated citizen participation in government rule. So to understand that, let's take an example of a group. For example, in a class, so there is a class and there is an election of monitor. So often teacher used to ask us to raise our hand so that if we want a person A as monitor, people should raise hand. If we want the B candidate, students are asked to raise hand. So it is the direct and unmediated participation in rules. So all adult citizens take part in decision making. In direct democracy, all the adult citizens are the persons who take part in decision making. So direct democracy wipes out the distinction between the government and the governed and the state and civil society. Because people are participating in the government, in the democratic procedure on their own. So there is a very, no distinction between the government and the governed. So direct democracy ensures greater legitimacy as people are more likely to follow decisions which are taken by them only. So because people are themselves taking a decision and themselves taking a part in decision making, so it is believed that they are more likely to follow that decision because it is them only who made that decision. So ancient Greek city-state model was an example of direct democracy. At that point of time, in ancient time, it was in Greece that this kind of direct democracy was there. But nowadays, direct democracy can be found in Swiss cantons. So, with the growing of states, it is found out that practicing direct democracy is quite difficult. Because in such a huge state, huge nation state, it is not feasible to allow direct democracy because of the growing population. Next comes the representative democracy. It is limited and indirect form of democracy where it is indirect as people do not exercise power directly but through their elected representatives. For example, in India, we elect MPs for Lok Sabha and in return, all those elected MPs choose a prime minister for us. So it is indirect. We are not voting for a prime minister's post, but for member of parliament who will be further choosing the prime minister. So it is indirect. So there are two kinds of democracies all over the world. That is presidential form and parliamentary form. And these are representative democracies. So in presidential form of government, the head of the government is the president, whereas in parliamentary form of government, the head of the government is the prime minister. So parliamentary democracies are more representative than the presidential, but at the same time, they are relatively less deep. So let's move on to gender. Gender is one of the major concepts or one of the most important topic in this course. And we should understand gender. And it, from exam point of view also, this is a very important topic. The word gender is being used sociologically or as a conceptual category. It is new incarnation. Gender refers to the socio-cultural definition of man and women. So there is a difference between the word sex and gender, because sex is something which is biological. So male and female, they have some kind of biological differences. But gender, the term gender is a society's creation between a man and a woman, where man is considered to be a chivalrous, stronger person who is very macho in that sense. But whereas it is expected from a woman to be caring, loving, submissive. So these differences are society's creation. So it is the society which distinguish men and women and assign them social roles. So some kind of roles are assigned to them. For example, men are assigned the role of going out and earn and produce materials or do all the chores from public life. Whereas everything which comes under a household or private sphere is given to women. So for example, cooking food, taking care of children, caring their parents, all these things which comes under the private sphere is assigned to women. So the distinction between sex and gender was introduced to deal with the general tendency to attribute women's subordination to their anatomy. So all the social and cultural packaging that is done for boys and girls from birth onwards is gendering. For example, since a girl is born in the family, she is given toys like kitchen sets. So this is gendering because it is to make her understand that you are supposed to do kitchen works when you grow up. Whereas boys are giving car, guns, toys. Why? Because it is believed that while growing up, the boy will take up the job of, he will be driving the car, he can play with gun because he will be the one who will be protecting the family. So this starts from the very young age in a family, which genders them, which create the differences. So according to Anne Oakley, gender is a matter of culture. It refers to the social classification of men and women into masculine and feminine. There are some kinds of attributes related to this, that like masculine things like macho-ness, chivalrous, strong, whereas feminine activities are caring, loving, submissive towards the husband and family. So all these things are distinguishes between a man and a woman. So gender is deeply embedded in every aspect of society, in our institutions, in public places, in art, clothing, and movement. So the concept of gender needs to be understood clearly as a cross-cutting socio-cultural variable such as race, class, age, ethnic group, etc. So gendered roles are learned through socialization processes. They are not fixed but are interchangeable. So gender refers to both women and men and the relations between them. That is very important to understand. So gender inequalities stem from relations of power and authority, class, caste, hierarchies, and socio-cultural traditions, customs, and norms. So it also talks about patriarchy. Patriarchy is the systemic societal structures that institutionalize male physical, social, and economic power over women. So the roots of patriarchy are often located in women's reproductive role and sexual violence. So it is believed that women can be sexually exploited, and that is why women should stay home, they should not go outside because there is a possibility that they can be sexually abused. So it is their reproductive role which from where the patriarchy is connected. So the main sites of patriarchal operation have been identified as housework, paid work, in culture, sexuality, and violence. So let's talk about three waves of feminism, first wave, second wave and third wave, how feminism emerged over time. So the first wave emerged in the 19th and early 20th century, which talks about women's suffrage movement. They were wanting voting rights for them. The second wave emerged in the 1960s and 60s, and it refers to the ideas and actions associated with the women's liberation movement. And here they don't want, they were given voting rights, but in second wave they wanted social rights for women. In the third wave, it started from 1990s, and it refers to the continuation of and a reaction to perceived failures of the second wave of feminism. So let's talk about citizenship. We have understood citizenship in our this course. So citizenship is the status of a person recognized under the custom or law as being a legal member of a sovereign state or a part of nature. So we can say that it is recognition, a status given to a people through custom or law, which allows him to become the legal member of a state which is sovereign in nature. So a person may have multiple citizenship. Some countries allows multiple citizenship, some can't. So a person who does not have citizenship of any state is said to be stateless. So migrants are often known as stateless because they don't have citizenship of any country. So the term citizens can be understood in a narrow or in a broad sense. In narrow sense, it means the resident of a city or one who enjoys the privileges of living in a city. Whereas if we talk about broader sense, citizen means a person who resides within the territorial limits of the state. So there is a two concepts or two senses through which citizenship could be understood. So there are some kinds of determining factors related to this. So each country has its own policy, regulations and criteria as to who is entitled to citizenship. So a person is granted citizenship in a number of grounds. Usually citizenship is given to a person if his or her birth is in that country. So citizens are two types, natural born and naturalized. The natural born citizens are those who are the citizens of a state by the virtue of their birth or blood relation. Whereas naturalized citizens are those foreigners who are granted the citizenship of the country on the fulfillment of conditions laid down by the respective country. So there are many cases where foreigners are given citizenship to a country, how they have to accept the few conditions laid down by the country where they are applying from citizenship. So for foreigners to have citizenship in a country, they need some kind of application. They have to apply for that citizenship. So let's talk about the idea of global citizenship. It is the supporters of the global citizenship believe that all people have certain rights and responsibility by virtue of being a citizen of this world. So under globalization, which became a major concept in late 20th century, the idea of citizenship is being challenged by activities like migration, transnational economy, social and cultural exchange, which was, we can see that with globalization, all these new things were happening, which are challenging the idea of citizenship. So, according to global citizenship, they criticize, and the idea of global citizenship can also be criticized and is largely focuses on duties toward others and on loyalties to communities which are wider than the nation state rather than on active citizenship. So this idea is also being criticized. So let's talk about the concept of civil society. Idea of civil society is deeply entrenched in political thought. The idea of civil society is quite old, but it has become important in last few decades. So the term civil society can be traced through the works of Cicero and other Romans to the ancient Greek philosophers. So, in ancient times, the civil society and state are used simultaneously. So, in modern idea of civil society emerged in the Scottish and continental Enlightenment in the late 18th century. So the civil society is a domain parallel to but separate from a state, a place where citizens voluntarily associate according to their own interest and wishes. So here is a voluntary activities provided by the citizens in a civil society. So the concept of civil society flourished along with the idea of individual with respect to his rights. So his relations with other individuals and the state. So this was the concluding lecture on BPSC 131, Introduction to Political Theory. Next, I will be taking sessions on BPSC 132, Indian Government and Politics from the next time. So, thank you.